For 80 years, the BBC World Service has been broadcasting around the world.
From Dira Dunia to NewsHour.
From Daraklar to World Heavier Sea.
From Dunida Yamanta to Outlook.
From Noktat Hiwar to The Strand.
Today on the BBC World Service, the world's radio station.
AM in London, 5 AM in Washington, 1 PM in Nairobi. This is Dan Damon with World Update from the BBC. Mitt Romney secures a narrow victory in the Republican primary in the state in which he was born, so why is his main opponent also celebrating?
A month ago, they didn't know who we are, but they do now.
Also ahead, new research claims to pinpoint the exact origins of a virus now affecting millions worldwide.
Virtually all of the cases of AIDS that we know about can be traced back to a single transmission event. This one event occurred between 80 and 120 years ago.
Plus, years of the BBC World Service. And what does the future hold for international radio broadcasting? Those stories to come after the latest world news headlines.
BBC News with Mike Cooper. The front-runner for the Republican presidential nomination in the United States, Mitt Romney, is celebrating important victories in the latest two primary elections. He won in Arizona and his home state of Michigan, where he faced a strong challenge from Rick Santorum. Our North America editor Mark Mardell watched Mitt Romney's victory speech in Michigan.
And in this room are the people who knocked on the doors and made the calls and went to the polls, and it made an enormous difference. We didn't win by a lot, but we won by enough, and that's all that counts.
Despite the crowd's enthusiasm, he still hasn't won the right to face President Obama in the autumn, but it's an important step on the way. This was a hard fight in a state that should have been an easy win for Mitt Romney. He was born and brought up in Michigan, and his father was a much-loved governor. But Christian conservative Rick Santorum made a very strong showing for a candidate who was barely taken seriously until the beginning of the year.
A committee of the Australian Senate has called on the government to make a formal apology for its part in forcing unmarried mothers to give up their babies for adoption. Many women have told a Senate inquiry that they were shackled to their hospital beds or drugged before signing consent forms. Duncan Kennedy reports.
The harrowing stories were given by women who were usually in their teens and unmarried in the 1960s and 70s. Many said they'd signed consent forms allowing adoption only after being coerced. Some said they'd been given sedatives, whilst others said their signatures had been forged. The practice of taking away babies was the result of the stigma attached to unmarried mothers at the time and by the demand for children by infertile couples.
The Greek Prime Minister Lucas Papademos is visiting Brussels to seek final approval for a second European Union-led bailout deal for his country's beleaguered economy. He'll meet senior officials before attending an EU summit later this week. On Tuesday, the Greek Parliament approved another round of spending cuts worth $4.3 billion. Officials say a crippled Italian cruise ship being slowly towed to the Seychelles is expected to arrive in port early on Thursday morning. The Costa Allegra started drifting in the Indian Ocean on Monday after a fire knocked out its power. Katie Watson reports from the Seychelles.
As the passengers on board Costa Allegra continue their slow journey to dry land, Seychelles authorities are trying to prepare for the influx of more than 1,000 people at a time that's already busy for the island in the run-up to Carnival. The more than 600 passengers and 400 crew are expected to arrive early Thursday morning. Hotels around the island of Mahé, which is home to the capital Victoria, are being asked to put passengers up in any available room. Executives from Costa Cruises have arrived in the capital, and Seychelles Civil Aviation Authority say the company has chartered two planes to take people back to Rome. A third Air Seychelles plane will carry any remaining passengers to Italy to ensure they return home safely after a holiday that turned into a nightmare.
I'm Mike Cooper in London with world news from the BBC. A senior American military commander has said US food aid for North Korea is now being linked to political conditions, apparently contradicting official American policy. Admiral Robert Willard, who commands the US Pacific Fleet, said the conditions included an end to Pyongyang's nuclear weapons program. Washington has previously insisted that the two issues are separate. One of Europe's biggest lenders, Erste Bank, has reported losses of $968 million for 2011. The bank said its losses would have been significantly bigger if it hadn't made a $340 million profit in the final quarter of that year. The BBC's audience for its news services in Iran has risen by 85% in the past 3 years, despite what the corporation says is an increase in official censorship and intimidation. With more details, here's our media correspondent, Torin Douglas.
The BBC says that for its Persian service journalists, interference and harassment from the Iranian authorities has become a daily fact of life. Despite this and the jamming of TV signals, the Independent Broadcasting Board of Governors says over 7 million people a week in Iran are watching or listening to the BBC. It's a reminder of the important role played by the BBC World Service since its beginnings as the fledgling Empire Service in 1932.
This is London.
Today, the World Service celebrates its 80th anniversary with a day of special programming from Bush House.
65 million years after Tyrannosaurus rex became extinct, a study has found that the dinosaur had the most powerful jaws of any creature that's ever walked the Earth. Scientists here in Britain measured the bite of the Tyrannosaurus by making a digital model of its skull. They say the force generated by two of the creature's back teeth crashing together was equivalent to being sat on by a medium-sized elephant. BBC News.
Hello, you're listening to the BBC World Service. Happy birthday to us. This is World Update, and in this part of the programme, harrowing testimony from young mothers forced to give up their children at birth in Australia. Plus, the German charities opening their mail, discovering they've been sent tens of thousands of euros in cash. Who's doing it? First, in the US, the Republican race to decide which candidate will challenge Barack Obama for the presidency of the United States overnight. The favourite, former Massachusetts Governor Mitt Romney, won two important primaries in Arizona. He beat challenger Rick Santorum, a former senator, with 47% of the vote to 27%. Closer in Michigan, Mr. Romney was born there. His father used to be governor. Despite that home ground advantage, he managed a 3% victory over Mr. Santorum. Nonetheless, he was clearly relieved.
You know, a week ago, the pundits and the pollsters, they were ready to count us out. But across Michigan and Arizona, I kept on meeting moms and dads and students and grandparents, and they were concerned about what's happening to this great country of ours. And I was confident that we could come together today and take a giant step toward a brighter future. So tonight, their efforts have brought our cause a great victory, and we celebrate with people across these states. Thank you.
Mitt Romney wasn't the only one sounding like he'd scored a victory, though. Two of the candidates, former House Speaker Newt Gingrich, Libertarian Ron Paul, didn't campaign in either state. They polled poorly, but Rick Santorum did campaign. He's clearly content with his close second placing.
A month ago, they didn't know who we are, but they do now. What an absolutely great night. I am so thankful. First and foremost, I just have to say to the people of Michigan, you know, we came into the backyard of one of my opponents in a race that everyone said, well, just ignore, you have really no chance here. And the people of Michigan looked into the hearts of the candidates, and all I have to say is, I love you back. Thank you.
Rick Santorum, Super Tuesday next week, so where are we? Our North America editor, Mark Mardell, has spent the night with the Romney campaign in Michigan.
The main emotion that was on show at his victory party tonight was one of relief. If he hadn't won this, it would have opened up a floodgate of questions from senior Republicans saying, is he really the man? Could somebody else come into the race? Now, that may have been unrealistic talk, but it would have happened. And I think that the narrowness of the victory in what is really his home state, where he was born, where he's brought up, where his dad was a very popular governor, against Santorum, who was barely known here up until a few weeks ago, shows just the volatility of the Republican electorate and that they're not desperately in love with Mitt Romney.
And later we'll talk to a Mitt Romney supporter. The ambivalence shown by some members of the Republican Party towards the candidates could be some real problems ahead for the Republicans later in the summer. A Senate committee in Australia today recommended that a national apology be given to thousands of women who were forced to give up their children for adoption. The committee heard hundreds of submissions by women who said they were restrained and drugged before they were asked to sign away their children. Some women say they were lied to, told their babies had died. It's thought tens of thousands gave up their babies in this way during the 1960s and 70s. Here's Duncan Kennedy in Sydney.
In 1966, Patsy Gall was 15 when she gave birth to a baby boy in Melbourne.
It was totally unexpected that I wasn't allowed access to my son. Pleading with the nurses and with the social worker, she was in plain clothes, and she just said no emphatically that I couldn't hold him. It was like a machine. No one told me when I get into hospital I wouldn't be able to hold him. No one said that.
In 1967, Robin Turner was 17 when she also gave birth to a boy in Sydney.
They asked me, if you won't sign these papers, you know, you don't care about your son, you don't love your son because you can't look after him. Are you going to become a prostitute to support you and your son? After all, that's all you're qualified for.
Both Robin and Patsy before her were just two of what's now believed to be tens of thousands of young, unmarried Australian women who were forced to hand over their babies in the 1960s and 70s. Like the music, the period was one of liberation and experimentation. But the revolution in sexual freedoms had not yet affected the stigma of unmarried women giving birth. Hospitals used a range of methods to get them to sign adoption consent forms, from sedatives to coercion. Faye Nyson was another teenager given no choice.
Only selfish mothers keep their babies. I was told that. And if I really loved her, I would do what's best for her. And that was the thought of the day, I suppose. So I do feel it was coerced.
Social workers were among those assigned to persuade the women to hand over their babies. This one, who doesn't want to be identified, said her job was simple.
Essentially, my job was to shut them up, stop them crying, get them to realise that giving up their baby was the best thing that they could do, and get on with it. There are good couples with good education, good home, good everything, who really want to have a child. And you're being selfish to deny your child the opportunity of a good life in a good home, a much better life than you could provide.
Many women want a formal government apology, similar to the one issued to Indigenous people by the former Prime Minister Kevin Rudd in 2008. Some, like Monica Jones, who went on to have a family of her own, say it's affected their whole life.
That was the real me, the me that fell pregnant. And that me has never resurfaced, ever. I've always been damaged, permanently damaged.
And all, like Robin Turner, whose hobby is knitting, say they'll never forget their first lost child.
I waited 21 years, and every year I knitted him a jumper. From the age of 1 to 21, and I kept them all. So when he eventually turned up, if he was alive, he would know that I loved him and I cared for him.
A report from Duncan Kennedy. Iran's parliamentary election takes place on Friday. The opposition's called for a boycott, and we've been providing some background on World Update this week. Now hear from a former Iranian Revolutionary Guard who says that he worked undercover as a CIA operative for several years in the 1980s and 90s. His pseudonym is Reza Khalili. He's now based in the United States, and he told me why he believes Western sanctions won't work with the Iranian regime and why, when it comes to the nuclear question, Iran might be further ahead than Western governments think. Reza distorted his voice during the interview to protect his identity and his family.
If you look at all the estimates that the intelligence agencies, including US, UK and others, made public, it has proven to be false and incorrect, that they had worked and continue to work along with help with scientists from foreign entities such as Russia, specifically on weaponization and detonation and the chain reaction throughout the years and recently. One thing you've got to understand, and I've disclosed this in the book, that the nuclear program project of Iran started in the mid-80s with the intention of getting the bomb. And the reason was that at that time, the intelligence division of the Revolutionary Guards had learned that Saddam Hussein was out there shopping for nuclear bomb in the black market through the Pakistanis and others. The ex-chief commander at that time, got the authorization from Ayatollah Khomeini, the supreme leader, to make the bomb. And that authorization letter was later on revealed briefly by Hashemi Rafsanjani in his dispute with Mohsen Rezai, then it was taken off table. It's been in the works for a long time. They believe that getting the nuclear bomb will make them untouchable and will checkmate the world, which is quite true due to the location of Iran in that geography, in that part of the world, right in the Persian Gulf and all the oil fields, which over 40% of world's energy lies. Now they have...
Well, indeed, and indeed what the Iranians would say, and a lot of people tell us when we put this question on social media, is, yes, Israel's got the bomb, why wouldn't Iran want to defend itself?
This is a silly argument. You see, first of all, no country, let alone Iran with the radical clerical establishment in charge, who has proven that they are very aggressive and they have called for the destruction of Israel and the demise of the West throughout their history, and their actions back it up. No other country should have the nuclear bomb in the Persian Gulf. Any nuclear exchange in that specific area could shut down all the oil fields because of contamination for years, and there won't be a single drop of oil coming out of that area. So it's not a matter of Iran alone. It's a matter of world security. Israel has nuclear bombs, but they have never threatened another country with annihilation or destruction or a nuclear attack. And Iran has, continuously has, the leaders of Iran have, not the people of Iran. And they continuously say that even Hashemi Rafsanjani, a moderate figure by many in the West, said that one nuclear bomb will destroy Israel. And he went further and said, even if 20 million Iranians die in the exchange, it is worth it. And this is from a moderate.
And do you think that in the end, to deny those Iranian leaders the weapon that they want, military action from outside will be necessary?
I wrote a letter to President Obama 2 years ago, before he approached the Iranian regime, once he had stepped into the White House, that negotiations is not going to work with the Iranian leaders, that sanctions are not going to work. It's not the economy. It is the ideology. And we could have helped the Iranian people in 2009 to bring about change without firing a single bullet and change the whole geopolitics of the region and the world. And right now, we have to inform the Iranian people. We have to establish a communication with them. We have to unite them and use this friendly ally. The majority of Iranians are westernized. They hate this regime. They want change. We have to bring them into this frame of thought that danger is imminent. But if it comes to war, which I believe it will come to a head, we shouldn't bomb Iran into a stone age. We shouldn't hurt the civilians. We should just attack through an air campaign the Revolutionary Guard bases, but with the Iranian people participation in coming out. Once we tell them they are protected, they will come out in millions and this regime would collapse. But if we only attack the nuclear facilities, this regime will get the bomb, they will come back stronger, and the region will go up in flames.
That's Reza Khalili, what's his real name. His book is called A Time to Betray, about his life as a CIA agent as well as a member of the Iranian Revolutionary Guard Corps. A Time to Betray. Well, we're celebrating 80 years of the BBC, and on the World Service page, lots of congratulations for the 80th birthday. Of course, one of the reasons we're making a special deal of it is because we're leaving Bush House shortly, and this programme will be one of the first to be broadcast from the new facility, which is not very far away, and I'm promised will be full of nice, new, shiny equipment, which I love. A lot of congratulations. Not everyone is in favour. The BBC is the official mouthpiece for the fascist British Empire. That's Cliff Webb. You're invading our shores. I think he's in the United States. This is World Update. Indeed, happy birthday to us, and a party in the car park celebrating the 80th birthday of the BBC World Service. And I'm sure you would agree, but you're-
what could fit more perfectly than to have a world party on the day you came to be. Happy birthday to you.
And we'll look at how technology is changing the world of international broadcasting. That's to come later here on World Update. Top stories at the moment. The Republican presidential frontrunner in the United States, Mitt Romney, has secured his party's nomination in Michigan after a tight race. He won in Arizona as well. An Australian Senate committee has called for a government apology to thousands of women who had their children forcibly taken from them and given up for adoption. And scientists have concluded the Tyrannosaurus rex had the most powerful jaws of any creature ever to walk the earth. Plus, we'll look at the source of the AIDS infection and the epidemic that's to come here on World Update. This is Dan Damon with World Update from London. How would you feel if you found an envelope with 10,000 euros in notes in your letterbox? That's happened not once, but several times in and around the German city of Braunschweig. Peter Jagler is a reporter who's investigated the story for the local German public broadcaster NDR, and he joins us now. Peter, thanks very much indeed for being with us on World Update. Where are the envelopes turning up?
Well, it's a miracle. They generally turn up in normal letterboxes, in mailboxes. Those envelopes are white, and there never was a name on them so far. So people see those envelopes, open them, and then they find normally $2,500 notes in them, and that sums up to 10,000 euros, actually, not dollars.
And the it's mostly charities and those involved in good works who are getting the money, is that correct?
Yeah, that's correct. It's charity, it's churches, it's kindergartens. And the thing about the envelopes is, as they have no address on them, people, you know, you would think people don't know what to do with the money or what the money is for. However, the person or the people who donate the money, they put a copy from our local newspaper in it. And on that copy, they highlight an article usually on, let's say, the charity or a kindergarten or whatever. And that's why people assume that the money is, you know, meant to go to the kindergarten in the case or to charity.
Now, there's lots of speculation, but one of the ideas is that this is the outcome of a bank robbery. Is that right?
Well, you know, we've been talking to the police. We spoke to banks in our area as well. They checked the money and they couldn't really find anything on the money, which, you know, would lead the investigator to think that this money is, you know, coming from a bank robbery or anything like that. So as far as, you know, police can say at the moment, we assume the money, you know, must come from a good person, I suppose.
Right. So it's a neat idea, this kind of Robin Hood who's stolen from the banks and, of course, a lot of unpopular banks around at the moment in Europe and is giving it to good causes. But it may just be that, just a story. How much has been donated so far?
Can you believe it? We had 19 envelopes, 19 times 10,000. That comes to 190,000 euros so far.
Which is more than $200,000. That's serious money.
Indeed, that's serious money. It's like a, you know, it's like a Robin Hood, a modern Robin Hood, probably. A good story to tell. Our local newspaper always reported on that story, and I've spoken to the chief editor as well, and he said, look, you know, normally news always tell you the bad things which happened in the world. However, at the moment, we have this wonderful story, which is a good story, a positive story for our region. And he said that journalists from all around the world at the moment are covering that story because it is a story which in that way probably never happened before.
Wonderful. Thanks very much indeed. That's Peter Jagler from the German public broadcaster NDR and the donor, whoever it might be, of Braunschweig, yet to come clean. Well, from a good news story to one that's less optimistic, although efforts are being made. 10 years after the end of the civil war in Sierra Leone, one of the poorest countries in the world, considerable progress is underway. Democratic elections have been held. The army and security forces have been rebuilt. The economy is growing. But most Sierra Leoneans are still extremely poor. And decent health care, particularly for mothers and babies, that is a real challenge. The BBC's international development correspondent Mark Doyle has returned to Sierra Leone to take stock a decade after the end of the war.
I look for pregnant women who are really less privileged. I pay most attention to teenagers because they have high risk in terms of delivery.
Early morning in a slum area of the Sierra Leone capital, Freetown.
I'm arriving here with a community nurse who's doing a remarkable job.
We go houses by houses. Onado!
As soon as Aminata Ngabai steps out of her car, pregnant women, many just teenagers, emerge from the surrounding shacks.
Brother Market, the motorcar is not there. We're not going to wait for you there.
Aminata tells all the pregnant women to go to the marketplace to register for medical attention.
So we're
just go there, she tells them, and wait for me by the car.
You, go wait for me.
A trained local expert targeting some of the poorest and most vulnerable people in the world. No bureaucracy, no time wasting, straight to the point, helping teenage mothers deliver their babies safely.
They have not stopped growing yet. They need to eat well as they eat well for their baby. They have not grown yet. Their pelvic bones have not completed matured yet. And if these people are not well taken care of and they go into labor, they will eventually develop this problem.
Aminata Ngabai works for a health centre paid for by a British charity. It specialises in stopping women getting potentially fatal complications during pregnancy. In poor countries like Sierra Leone, that often includes a horrible complication called fistula, where vaginal tearing causes incontinence and often death. The clinic Aminata will send these women to is named after an area in Freetown called Aberdeen. So, the Aberdeen Women's Centre.
Aberdeen Women's Centre is there to see that every woman is free from fistula. And every woman is supposed to give birth safe and sound. Yes.
The help given by the charity in Freetown is important. But in the end, of course, the government here has to take responsibility for healthcare. And it has begun doing just that, implementing free mother and baby care across the country. That started 2 years ago. But the policy has been a victim of its own success. There's been a huge increase in demand for the free services, and the small number of government doctors and nurses in post-war Sierra Leone can't cope.
We have a couple of problems which we have to undo.
In her office in the capital, Freetown, the health minister, Zainab Bangura, is frank about what's still needed.
The human resource, the infrastructure, and then the equipment are the three issues which are basic problems. And of course, the specialist skills. So those are some of the challenges we have.
Is it just shortages, Minister, or is there a kind of attitude problem that some government hospitals seem to be run for the benefit of staff rather than for the benefit of patients?
Yes, I agree to some extent it's a problem. We have to take the human factor into consideration. And make it very clear that you have a social responsibility with the community. You have to treat the patient with a lot of self-respect and dignity, and you have to give them what it takes.
Back at the Aberdeen Women's Centre, two women who have had their fistula complications solved are being feted by the nurses and other patients. This is a once-a-week ceremony to say goodbye to patients and raise morale. And this being a very religious country, there are also prayers.
I thank you, Father, for in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
For in Jesus' name, worship.
Amen.
Shall be Jesus a big clap of
the two cured women, Mary and Mbalu, then shake the hands of everyone in the room and head home in new dresses supplied by the centre. Two more down, plenty still to go.
That's Mark Doyle reporting. And quick look at some financial numbers, and very little movement on the Nikkei in Tokyo, and on the Hang Seng, a rise of 5% at the close in Hong Kong. And there is a bigger rise on the DAX in Frankfurt at the moment. That's up 0.8%, 69.42. On currencies, dollar gets 80.6 yen and the euro gets $1.34.7 US cents. Oil prices heading upwards again. The April contract for New York light crude, $107.31 a barrel. And gold, $1,786.88 an ounce. This is the BBC.
This is London.
For 80 years, the BBC World Service has been reporting the world.
The motto of the British Broadcasting Corporation is Nation shall speak peace unto nation.
It's covered its fair share of war.
Ici, Londres. Les Français parlent aux Français. Honneur et patrie.
And try to deal fairly with all sides.
The Argentine colleagues were getting phone calls from their mothers in tears saying, why are you still working there? There is a war.
They're under attack again.
He's been there as the world order changes, and he's held world leaders to account.
So you don't think there was legal authority for the war?
I have stated clearly that it was not in conformity with the Security Council, with the UN Charter.
It was illegal?
Yes, if you wish.
The BBC World Service. 80 years of reporting the world.
This is World Update with Dan Damon. Mitt Romney gets his victories in Arizona and Michigan, but the three other candidates say they'll battle on. What's that doing to the Republican campaign? Remarkable research has identified the time and place the HIV virus crossed from apes to humans and how it spread around the world. It is a story full of surprises. Plus, the secrets of the Vatican archives. We'll speak to David Willey, who's been allowed to read some newly revealed documents. First, the news headlines.
BBC News with Mike Cooper. The front-runner for the Republican presidential nomination in the United States, Mitt Romney, is celebrating important victories in the latest two primary elections. He won Arizona more comfortably than expected, but analysts say his narrow victory in Michigan may prove more significant. There, Mr. Romney fought off a determined challenge from the Republican conservative Rick Santorum. A committee of the Australian Senate has called on the government to make a formal apology to tens of thousands of women who had their babies forcibly taken from them for adoption. The practice was widespread in the 1960s and 70s, when having children outside marriage was regarded as socially unacceptable. China has added its voice to increasingly urgent international calls for humanitarian aid to be allowed into Syria for those wounded in the violence. The Chinese Foreign Minister, Yang Jiechi, is reported to have backed the move after speaking to Arab foreign ministers and the Arab League head, Nabil Al-Arabi. The Greek Prime Minister, Lucas Papademos, is visiting Brussels to seek final approval for a second European Union-led bailout deal for his country's beleaguered economy. He'll attend an EU summit later in the week. One of Europe's biggest lenders, Erste Bank, has reported losses of $968 million for 2011. The bank said its losses would have been significantly bigger if it hadn't made a profit in the final quarter of last year. A senior American military commander has said U.S. food aid for North Korea is now being linked to political conditions. Admiral Robert Willard said the conditions being discussed included an end to Pyongyang's nuclear weapons program. And special programmes are being broadcast here on the BBC World Service to mark the 80th anniversary of its founding. The programmes, produced live from large tents in the central courtyard of Bush House in London, bring together English language services output with that of many of the other language services. BBC News.
This is Dan Damon with World Update from the BBC World Service. Mitt Romney has just scored a hard-fought victory in his native state of Michigan. His victory in Arizona was more convincing. The sweep of Tuesday's contests for Mr. Romney marks the latest turn in what's been a turbulent Republican primary campaign. It should cement his status as the party's front-runner to challenge President Barack Obama in the November presidential election. But the knockout punch, probably still missing. With us is Charlie Wolfe, a Republican broadcaster, a supporter of Mitt Romney. There seems to be a bit of an enthusiasm deficit in the Republican Party at the moment.
Oh, that's a fair point, I think. I think what was interesting from yesterday isn't so much that Mitt Romney won, but Rick Santorum lost. This was Santorum's one chance to really have a stake, to make a claim to fame, and he lost it. And I think he lost it partly on the debate, and partly I think that I don't want to necessarily say loose cannon, but these comments about Satan and contraception, as important as they may be to Republicans and to conservatives, I should say more to social conservatives, that's not what the race is going to be about. That's not what's going to win things in November. It was interesting looking at the exit polling from Michigan. Yes, Santorum took voters who identify themselves as very conservative, amongst those who say they want a true conservative, but what he didn't win on was voters who said they were voting because they want to beat Obama in November. And Mr. Romney is still seen as the only candidate with a fair shot of fighting on the economy and beating Mr. Obama on the economy. This is not a year for ideology. If this was 2016 and Mr. Obama was still in office and, of course, couldn't run again and going up against a Democratic unknown, then you can go for ideology. But right now, I think there's a feeling within the United States, amongst especially conservatives and especially amongst independents, that they don't want another 4 years of Mr. Obama, and they're looking for someone to beat him. And right now, that's seeming to be Mr. Romney.
Super Tuesday coming up next week. Now, is that going to be the clincher, do you hope, for Mitt Romney? And what's the evidence?
Well, I'm not sure, because obviously he's not going to win everything. For instance, Newt Gingrich is pinning his hopes on winning in Texas and a couple of the larger states. But Karl Rove had written an article recently in the Wall Street Journal saying that the strategy is that Gingrich is employing really is not going to work.
And Georgia, that's likely to be a victory for Gingrich.
I think one of the problems that we have is not so much with the candidates, but with the process. The Republicans had changed into this more proportional system instead of winner-takes-all. Some states, Arizona, for instance, are winner-take-all. And this is what's really kind of dragged the thing out. I think there will be serious conversations in Tampa and post-Tampa at the RNC level on how to change the system. I think they'll go back to more of a winner-take-all contest, because this is what I think has really made it hard for someone like Mr. Romney to clinch this. He's taken six very important states,
He's had to move to the right, to more conservative positions to do that, hasn't he? When it comes to the election in November, it's the center you have to win. Has he been pushed too far to the right?
I don't think so, because he has a history of being pragmatic. Let's not forget, he was...
Flip-flop.
Well, not so much flip-flop. He was a conservative governor in the most liberal state in the union. That takes a level of pragmatism and working with others, which I think he can demonstrate the president has not been able to do, and he's in a far better position. Even on something like abortion, it's not that he is pro-abortion, but he realized that when you're in a very liberal state, the public has to be self-determinant. So I think he is going to be more... a candidate that will be more open to independents. We're going to say he's not going to be foisting his own conservative values down their throats.
Charlie, thanks so much indeed. More to be said, and we'll be saying it, no doubt, in the coming weeks. But thanks so much for that. For now, that's Charlie Wolfe. Well, we are unlikely ever to know all the details of the birth of the AIDS epidemic, but a series of genetic discoveries made recently has shed new light on how it all began. And they indicate that colonialism in Africa played a key role in the spread of the disease. Award-winning AIDS researcher Daniel Halperin is co-author of Tinderbox, a new book which details how AIDS became a global epidemic.
Virtually all of the cases of AIDS that we know about can be traced back to a single transmission event from one chimpanzee to one human being. And scientists who've been focusing on this estimate that this one event occurred between 80 and 120 years ago.
Geographically, can you pinpoint it?
Scientists have identified forms of the simian virus, which is very similar to HIV, in chimpanzees and other primates. But the simian virus is almost identical to the form of HIV, which has affected the vast majority of cases in humans in the world. They've only found it in one very remote part of southeastern Cameroon. And so we're nearly certain that that transmission event happened in that area.
And I suppose many people would be surprised that this happened more than 100 years ago, because in the popular imagination anyway, AIDS is something from the 1980s.
Well, that's exactly right. Until 5 or 10 years ago, scientists surmised that the birth of HIV, as we know it, happened probably in the 1940s or 1950s, roughly in that range. And it's only in recent years that we've had some really remarkable genetic evidence emerge showing that HIV most likely emerged about 100 years ago, roughly in the range of 1880 to 1920. That exactly coincides with the same period when the colonial powers were making their way through that very remote part of southeastern Cameroon. And we believe that without that heavy influx suddenly of colonial power and the thousands of African porters that they brought through that area, we believe that HIV would have done what it's probably done for centuries, if not millennia, which is it would have just affected a few people and fizzled out, and we never would have heard of it before.
So it's the porters that the colonialists used going through that area of East Cameroon that seemed to have spread the virus.
I don't think anyone will ever know exactly what happened. But we do know, until the 1880s, that was a very remote area. Very few human beings were in there. And the few that were there were the so-called Baka, or pygmy people, who pretty much stuck to themselves. And they were so sparsely populated that an epidemic like HIV could never have taken hold. That all changed quite dramatically when you had the Germans and the French and the Belgians in that area doing a lot of work around logging, but particularly around the collection of ivory and rubber for the global economy at that time. And this involved bringing in basically a forced slavery where they, at gunpoint, brought thousands of African workers in from other areas to extract the rubber and the ivory and so on. And you suddenly had a lot of people coming in and going out, as well as prostitution and other things that basically laid the siege to actually become an epidemic, and then decades and decades later to actually become a global epidemic as we know it today.
And the original transmission from chimpanzee, from simian to human, that would have been by blood, but the later transmission, that's more likely to have been sexual because of all these porters forced into this work, and there are women around who have been infected?
We've been able to unearth historical data showing that, among other things, these porters were not fed, so they worked very hard, but they were not given very substantial rations, so they would have been hungry, and quite likely some of them would have been butchering some of the local animals, including chimpanzees, for food. And butchering a large animal like a chimpanzee can be quite a bloody experience, and it's certainly plausible that the blood from the chimpanzee would have entered an open wound from one of these men, and then it could spread through sexual contact.
Some of which sexual contact probably was forced. I guess rape was a dimension here too.
Well, there were certainly rapes in that area. It was a very disruptive period historically. We don't know exactly, but for example, the porter who was infected by the chimpanzee could have gotten on a steamboat. The Germans and the Belgians and others had traffic going up and down those rivers. What we do know is that virus eventually made it to Leopoldville, which had transformed dramatically from a very small village into what would become a substantial urban area, the first one really in that whole area of Africa that ever existed. And there in the city, you've got many people living in close quarters. You've got a lot of prostitution. And we know from the historical record that there was a lot of other sexually transmitted diseases that were epidemic at that time.
Can you pinpoint when it came to Europe?
Virtually all the cases of HIV that exist to this day in the Western Hemisphere and in Europe, all of those can be traced back to a single transmission event that occurred in Kinshasa or somewhere in the Congo during the 1960s when a large number of Haitian professionals were working in Congo. One of those Haitians came back infected with the type B of HIV-1, which is actually quite rare in Africa. You don't find subtype B almost at all in Africa. Over 99% of people with HIV in the United States, as well as Latin America and as well as Europe, all have the same subtype B. Once it got to the United States, it quite rapidly made its way to Europe by air transport.
So what can we learn from this very careful and detailed research that you've done?
If we understand how the disease evolved and what conditions allowed it to grow in some places and to not grow in others, then that can help us potentially prevent further spread and, in fact, reverse the spread, we believe, even dramatically.
That's Daniel Halperin, co-author of a new book called Tinderbox, speaking to us on an internet line from Mozambique, where he's carrying out further research. Well, today, the BBC World Service celebrates its 80th birthday. The BBC Empire Service began in 1932 for those, as King George V put it in the first ever royal Christmas message, so cut off by the snow, the desert or the sea that only voices out of the air can reach them.
One of the marvels of modern science, I am enabled this Christmas Day to speak to all my peoples throughout the empire.
Now here is a statement in French of great importance to our French listeners by General de Gaulle, le gouvernement français.
Good morning from London. This is the BBC broadcasting to Latin America in Spanish.
This is the BBC Far Eastern Relay Station. English by radio.
The police commander on duty here at Checkpoint Charlie has suddenly announced that they can go over, even though they may not have the right documents, and they're simply charging now through the small gate in the fence.
I never really felt that I was alone all the time, partly thanks to the BBC, which kept me in touch with the rest of the world.
Just a few memories from so many. Well, technology and global politics have, of course, changed the mission of the BBC World Service. Now its journalists are based, a lot of them, around the world, and its audience has grown into many, many millions. Today, some of our programmes will come from a giant marquee in the centre of Bush House, so members of the public can enjoy the diversity. Before World Update came on the air, I visited that marquee to speak to some of those involved in the celebration. First, Alexei Solohubenko, he's editor for Multimedia and Languages, on another special event, the live broadcast of the day's main planning meeting.
Shaping the agenda for 225 million people around the world who are accessing content of the BBC Global News, and also 2 million people in the UK, so no pressure there. But in reality, what we do, we look at the stories, we shape the agenda, we see how we cover those stories, what is being done by languages, what is being done by programs like yours, what is being done by World TV, what is being done by online. And we put it all together and see how we can best treat stories to make them accessible, to make them easy to understand. And that's the purpose of the meeting.
And you're going to broadcast the meeting for the first time, the 9 o'clock meeting. It sounds very official.
Very official.
How central is it to what happens in the rest of the output?
We're not command and control structure, therefore it's not a Politburo decision, but nevertheless this is an important decision which gives you the guidelines, which gives you the landmarks. This is what the BBC believes is important in terms of global coverage. We take these stories, we take the intellectual, I hope, discussion from the 9 o'clock meeting to the language services, to various programmes, and develop them. And the idea is that, yes, the meeting is important. I hope so, certainly.
And it's not normally done in a tent in the car park, but this is a very special day. It's the 80th birthday. What else will happen in this marquee today?
There'll be various language service programs. 16 of them will be broadcasting from here. NewsHour, all the landmark programs that are on air today will be also broadcasting from here. And I hope there'll be a lot of kind of rough interaction between different programs. So people may not expect polished sound today, but I hope they can expect a lot of excitement.
Alexei Solohubenko, and then I spoke to the woman in charge of the language services, Lillian Landor. What's the future of the 27 languages of the World Service?
The future for the whole of the World Service, I would say, is a pretty bright one. We have been assured that the World Service's grant will remain as is and in some ways may be augmented. So this is something that we're looking forward to.
Technology is making a difference, isn't it? You're doing more TV now, much more online. What are the promises? What are the opportunities there?
The World Service has changed enormously since, you and I remember it and we're working together. I would say that we have moved pretty dramatically from shortwave radio to online, mobile and TV. And so we're looking at different regions in the world and tailoring our platform, so to speak, to the region itself. So we're doing a lot of mobile in Africa, we're doing TV in the Arab world, we're doing TV bulletins for Pakistan and hopefully.
And what do you hope today will show?
Today will show what an extraordinary organization we are and what a brilliant place the World Service is, having 27 languages absolutely alive and kicking and having the impact that we do in the world and having this diverse workforce who all understand that journalism means first and foremost BBC journalism, which is impartial, which is free, and which does not tell you what to think, but encourages you to think. I think it's the most brilliant place to be at this point in time.
Lillian Landor, and there's lots of online live stuff as well, if you want to follow that, and the internet. And the headlines at the moment from the BBC newsroom: the Republican presidential frontrunner in the United States, Mitt Romney, has secured his party's nomination in Michigan after a tight race. He also won in Arizona. And the BBC World Service marking its 80th anniversary with special events and programming. This is World Update. And this is Dan Damon in London. Police in Rio de Janeiro have stepped up their ambitious drive to rid the city's urban slums of violent drugs gangs ahead of the 2014 World Cup and the 2016 Olympics. In a security program known as Pacification of the Favelas, Brazilian police are scaling up their efforts to include Rio's biggest favelas, where violence in the past has been the most acute. The BBC's Nina Robinson reports from one of these so-called slum cities, a place called Roxina.
It was the quietest I've ever heard Holcino. It was, and you know, this is a noisy, noisy, noisy place. And it was, you could hear a pin drop in Holcino. It was eerie.
A few months ago, in one of Rio de Janeiro's biggest favelas, home to over 100,000 people, Holcino, perched on the hills, saw an elite squad of police officers launch a huge security operation to take control from drug gangs. Marcos Burgos was there that night.
I just heard this noise. It felt like an earthquake going by, and it was basically like these tanks that were going up the street. They were so wide, they were too wide for the road. They even scraped up some of the sidewalk and people's doorsteps and stuff. And it was just like rattling the house and the windows. Then there were helicopters flying everywhere. You know, we knew it was on.
We've just been in the favela just for 2 minutes, and we're already seeing the elite force police squad in dressed all in black with heavily armed rifles, and they're just patrolling the area. Have they been patrolling quite a lot then?
Everywhere.
Nowadays, post-raid, the police have established control, and walking around the steep and narrow alleyways of Holcino with Marcos and my translator, we meet residents who are seeing its significant impact, like Rosemary.
Rosemary Nascimento Lima.
Do she live in Holcino?
Machado Holcino, in caso de Macega.
She lives in Macega, it's the highest part, Macega. Right. So what does she think of the pacification? Do you think that it's a good idea?
Tá. Ótima ideia.
Good idea. She's nodding quite ferociously. Why is it a good idea?
Porque tá mais calma.
She said it's much more quiet, calmer, relaxed. Before that, they had it was a bit dangerous to go up and you smell some smells of drugs and marijuana. And nowadays, you don't have this problem. The security is much better.
Holcino was a neighborhood controlled by young men with guns, adolescents, teens, guys in their early and mid-20s, onto their teeth.
Marcos has lived in Holcino for over a decade and helps run an NGO here called Mundo Real.
I really thought that it would be, from all the talk over the years, that it was going to be much harder for them to do what they did here, because these guys were seriously on. And now you see the same thing, but it's the police that are doing it.
One of the most important things for us is for the community to get along well with the police.
Colonel Rogério Seabra is in charge of establishing a new police force after the elite squad have done their job. 13,000 new community officers are being recruited over the next 5 years, who will be stationed in all Rio's favelas permanently. They're also helping to bring in desperately needed social services. And so far, the colonel says it's been working.
If you ask the communities where we are now established, they will tell you that the violence they had before is gone. This month, our figures are showing that in the 68 favelas we are currently operating in Rio de Janeiro, the number of homicides are half what they used to be. Robberies and petty crime have also been reduced by 50%.
The drug points are all hidden now. Most of them are, the big ones are gone. And, you know, you still have, they're still selling drugs here. I know that for a fact.
So really, it's just gone underground rather than it's gone away?
Yeah, just like in any other place in the world. Except for here, it was just, you know, it happened so fast. Because before it was, you know, this place was unbelievable before.
Have they just shifted the problem, you know, for it ready to resurface at any point?
I know that was what was happening before they pacified Holcino, because as they were pacifying all these other favelas, all those guys were coming here. So the last year in Holcino was really the worst I've ever spent here, because the neighborhood was flooded with gangsters from other neighborhoods that came here to hide out, so they were just spreading it.
Rádio Rocinha. As mariposas. At Holcino's community radio station, Osimar Santos plays samba and hears from his listeners, who are voicing some doubts on whether the momentum to solve Holcino's crime problems will continue to be prioritized in the longer term.
A lot of people think this is all happening just for the World Cup in 2014,
and the Olympics in 2016, and that after that date, the favelas will be abandoned again.
Radio DJ Osimar Santos sending that report by Nina Robinson from the favela of Josinha. And you can hear more of her report from Rio's urban slums on this week's assignment, if you search for that on the BBC World Service website. More than 1,000 years of myth and intrigue surrounds the documents that are held under tight security in the Vatican's secret archive.
Need access to the Vatican archives.
Professor, I don't think this is the appropriate moment.
Your petition has been denied 7 times.
No, this has nothing to do with my work. The path of illumination is a hidden trail through Rome itself that leads to the Church of the Illumination, the place where the Illuminati would meet in secret. But I can't find the start of the path until I get into the archives.
Clip from the film version of Dan Brown's thriller Angels and Demons, where the American symbologist Robert Langdon, Tom Hanks, attempts to stop a secret religious order from destroying the Vatican. Well, Langdon's task would be a bit easier, as 100 documents from the collection are leaving the archive for the first time in modern history to put on public display. And our Vatican correspondent, David Willey, has had a preview, and he joins us now. Exciting stuff, David.
Amazing stuff. There's a papal document relating to the excommunication of Martin Luther. There's the abdication document of Queen Christina of Sweden, who came here to Rome in the 17th century and created a sensation because she was the Protestant Queen of Sweden, and by stepping down from her throne and coming to live in Rome and accepting the hospitality of the Pope, she was going against the spirit of her times, and the Vatican thought it was going to be a major propaganda coup. But of course Queen Christina came here and started up her own rival court of men of literature and made her own art collections, in some ways a sort of rival to the Pope, and I don't think he liked it in the end, having her around. She stayed around here for 35 years. Then there's this amazing document sent by British nobles to Pope Clement V in 1530, demanding that Henry VIII be allowed to divorce Catherine of Aragon. It's a huge document, and it was lost for many centuries until sort of mid-20th century. It was found again in the Vatican archive and is now trotted out. British royalty, when they come to see the Pope, often see given a private view of this. But this is the first time in centuries that most of these documents have ever left the Vatican, and they're a very, very precious lot and a unique record of European history dating back. Well, the earliest document dates back even to before the year of the first millennium. It dates back to the 8th century BC. It's a beautifully written manuscript.
Sounds absolutely wonderful. And why has the Vatican decided to do this now?
Well, the secret, so-called secret archive, which was not actually, incidentally, one of the archivists told me that Dan Brown, who used the secret archive in his book, never bothered actually to ask for official permission. It's only open to scholars, to bona fide scholars, and he's certainly not a bona fide scholar, although he's a very wealthy man. Never actually consulted. This is a repository of documents, diplomatic documents, parchments, ancient manuscripts, all sorts of papal records dating back many centuries. It's almost uninterrupted since the beginning of the 12th century, so getting on for 900 years of papal records. And I was particularly interested as a graduate of Cambridge University to see that there's from 1321 there's a papal register announcing that the Pope has granted official permission for European scholars to gather in the University of Canterburgiensis to study. This is the papal authority for the founding of Cambridge University. And then there's a very, very sad letter from the Mary Queen of Scots in her own handwriting, written to the Pope shortly before she was executed. It's written in French, and it it's a very sad document, little document, and she describes herself as Reine d'Écosse, Queen of Scotland.
That's wonderful. Thank you very much indeed for giving us just a brief description of what must be really action-packed archival material. That's David Willey, and you've been listening to World Update from the BBC. Don't forget the podcasts. You can find us at World Update Daily Commute, and happy birthday to us. Have a look at all the very special events that you can find online and on the TV and radio.